Pettus Reed. Our chairman has had a little bit of surgery last week. He's at home, hopefully watching us this evening, and we want to wish him best. He's doing better after the surgery, but he'll be out for a little while, and I'll be sitting in for him, and we want to wish him the best in his recovery and hope to see him back soon. Especially myself, I look forward to having him back here in this seat, having him take care of these issues. So tonight, you probably will not see the expertise of Doug Schaefer here, but you'll have the desire of an individual trying to take care of this committee for you tonight. You all have had the opportunity to see the minutes from last month's meeting, and at this time, I'll take either approval or corrections to those minutes.
Make a motion to approve.
We have a motion.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries. I believe our first report is fire and rescue. Chief Farley.
For this month, North County Fire Rescue ran a total of 105 calls. We had three structure fires, had 22 motor vehicle accidents with injuries and 12 without injuries, three extrications. The next report is year to date on the department. We ran, actually had 43, we responded to 43 building structure fires so far this year. There's been 334 NVAs with injury and 127 motor vehicle accidents with no injuries. And I was misquoted, the other was the EMS runs, 195 motor vehicle accidents with injuries and 127 with no injuries. So I misquoted that. For a total call volume, 1,346 calls. The next sheet is a motor vehicle accident countywide. And you'll notice the ones that's highlighted in yellow are the responses that Rescue 1 had to make out of their territory because of another rescue being down at that time. Countywide, there was, it was up this month. We usually run about 45 to 50. There was 75 motor vehicle accidents. Average response time for rescue was 9.5 minutes. The next sheet shows countywide all the volunteer departments and their call volume, training hours, water usage. Countywide, so far this year, we've had 93 structure fires. And I was kind of looking back at last year at this time, we had 53 structure fires this time last year. And last year we had 312 NVAs year to date, and this year we've had 611. So call volume is definitely going up. Countywide call volume so far is 2,156 calls. That's countywide, all departments included in that call volume.
I think that's due to our growth, or
You know, the call volume's gone up, the structure fire's gone up. I can't remember we've had this many structure fires in 1 year. And like I say, we're at 93 this year, where we were this same time last year was 53. So that's quite a bit of jump. And of course, you got double NVAs. And I think anybody who drives through the city or county can see that possibility.
Yeah, we found out, you know, last month we got over 200,000 vehicles within this county. It's just going to happen.
Most times it seems like we're going the same way you're going. And then, of course, the last sheet shows the places that had fire damage that will require a permit is what we send to the county code department.
Any questions for the chief?
Where are we on the burn permit situation?
October 15th, you have to have a burn permit.
So today they have to call?
Mm-hmm. And they will carry us through May 15th.
I'll make a motion to approve this report.
Have a motion?
Second.
We have a second. Any discussion? If not, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
I have a budget amendment that Ms. Owen sent me after I submitted my report, so I'm going to need one of you a handout. Because of the, we sent a team of Swiftwater Rescue guys to South Carolina to help them during their disaster. And so I'm going to have some money put in my overtime and for Social Security and retirement and all that stuff. It's coming out of unassigned fund balance. This will be reimbursed to the county by FEMA. We're working with EMA at this time to get out our response. I think the EMS SORT also sent some guys down there that we work with, and they'll be doing the same process, I imagine, but we're going to get all this reimbursed by FEMA. And so this is asking to move these funds into these line items to be able to cover this, to pay the guys, and then we'll request this reimbursement and get reimbursement from FEMA on it.
So you're requesting $13,940?
Yes, sir.
How many did you send?
We sent two the first week with, EMS sent four. Two of them was in the command post, and they took the sustainment trailer down there. And then SORT sent two, and I sent two with them. And then because of staffing, when EMS come back, that I sent four to cover them. So they come back and had staffing issues, so I sent four. And they were gone for 3 or 4 days, and they came back. So I think it's a total of about 7, 8, 10 days. But we had a lot of response on our Facebook page, people from South Carolina thanking us for going down there. Of course, Murfreesboro sent a team, and EMS sent a team, we sent a team, and people were very appreciative of what we did down there and going down there to help and rescue people and just help people, you know, be moved from one place to the next.
So Laverne sent the team leader.
Yeah, Laverne sent a team leader. So it was very rewarding for my guys and all the rest of them too, I'm sure.
Any other questions?
I'll make a motion to approve the budget amendment.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? Would you call the roll?
Commissioner Gurley?
Yes.
Commissioner Nipper?
Yes.
Commissioner Piercy?
Yes.
Commissioner Reed?
Yes.
Commissioner Serino?
Yes.
Commissioner Turner?
Yes.
Chief, I believe we have some other firefighters here with us.
Yeah, we have the board member Dwayne Sadler with Christiana, Assistant Chief Mike Tapp, and the Chief of Eagle, Rick Parks, and the Eagle Police Chief with us tonight.
Sure do. Glad to have you with us, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate what you do.
Thank you.
All right. That's it.
Thank you. Thanks, Chief. All right, I believe we're ready for emergency management report.
Thank you. I have my report tonight, and I also have the EMPG grant monies that I'd like for y'all's permission to ask to get the mayor to sign so we can accept the money. You see my report, it's in front of you there. Typical month, except it's getting kind of busy toward the end of the month here. Last week we did a tabletop exercise with the Correctional Work Center. This week we planned on Wednesday doing the actual drill, but we're going to push that off until the 12th of November because it looks like Wednesday's going to be kind of rainy. And when you're using volunteers to help you out with these drills, you really don't want to lay them in the cold, wet ground and stuff like that when they're trying to be patients for you, such as that. But that'll be a good thing. Teaching a hazmat awareness class for the Rutherford County Fire for their rookie school tomorrow night. I'll be teaching that one. I like teaching that one because I get to meet the new firefighters, and also it's the easiest hazmat class to teach. Also, if you're interested, it's still not too late to sign up. The National Weather Service is coming down to the EOC on Thursday night at 6 p.m. to do a storm spotter class. It's something we do once or twice a year. They come down and do a really great job, get the community involved. And next week I'll be in
Chicago. Where will that be?
At the EOC.
At the EOC.
Next week I'll be at the Emergency Management Association of Tennessee Conference. That's our organization for emergency management. This month we had a total of 10 responses. 2 involved searches, 4 involved hazmats. We responded to a couple fires, one of them being an illegal fire, and 2 others. And by others, I mean that they thought there was something that we needed to be involved in, but when we got out there, we didn't really need to be. But it's always sometimes better to call us than and not need us in the other way around. But you have the report. It's pretty short and simple. You have any questions?
Questions? You must have done well.
That's right.
We have approval of the report.
Make a motion.
Have a motion. Have a second.
Okay.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Report's accepted. I believe you have.
Yes. We just got the grant contract for the Emergency Management Performance Grant Federal Fiscal Year 2015. They kind of operate a little bit behind. But basically, this is money. We are involved in this program. We give up quarterly reports and send a team out for stuff that, to be quite frankly, these stuff we would do anyway, just to make sure we're doing what we're supposed to do as an EMA. If you do well on this and you apply, you get the money every year. This is the same amount that we got last year. We usually get about $69,000 every year. It's pretty typical, and I'm just asking y'all to approve it.
Approve the grant, $69,350.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
No matching funds or anything?
No matching. This is something to do. It's a good program to keep EMAs that participate. Not all 95 counties participate in this. And basically, it's federal monies that are meant for this to help us keep a good, solid EMA program at the county level. It doesn't, of course, it doesn't come near fulfilling all our budgetary needs, but it does help.
And we do this every year.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions? Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Okay, have a motion.
Second.
And second. Do we need a roll call or just a
acclamation?
Right, okay. All those in favor of the grant?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Thank you,
sir. Juvenile detention.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
You have in front of you our reports for the month of September. a couple things I'd like to point out. Nothing too terribly exciting. But on the first report at the bottom, you'll still states that Wilson County owes $6,300. We have received that check, so I wanted to let you know that that's no longer owed. That has been paid. The rest of them, we don't anticipate any problems with. Usually this report from this committee comes prior to us receiving those checks in the mail. I'm also happy to report that our sexually transmitted diseases are down for the month. Instead of having a 12% positivity rate, we're down to 5. So that's awesome, and we're happy about that. If there's any questions on those first couple of pages, I'll happily answer them. And then I have a little bit to talk about regarding the Tennessee Alliance letter.
Any questions anybody has? just let you go ahead.
Okay, great. The last page of my report shows that we have received $73,967 of Title I funds from the state. This is a pass-through agency, basically. There's no matching funds on this. This is money that we use to for our educational programming services that we provide. The majority of it is a salary and benefits for our program coordinator. It also is used for our part-time education assistant, and then some various and sundry educational supplies. So we've received this, and what I would like to do, because I have a hard time remembering it, because the budget cycles are come at odd times, is to go ahead and ask for permission to apply for this grant for the next cycle. There's never any matching funds, and I'm going to also do my best to remember to again bring this up in August, but because we usually wrap our county budget up June, July, the Title I funds sort of get forgotten about. So I want to see if y'all, how you feel about for me asking permission to apply for this grant next year. And I was instructed by Lisa Nolan to flip that and see what the committee's opinion on it was.
Can you apply for it now, or is this permission to apply for it next year?
Permission for next year.
Next year.
Yes.
And you said you had it this year?
Yes, we've had it for several years now. But this go round, I didn't get it to committee in time. So we've received the grant. This is how much we've received for this year. And I'm trying to double cover my bases for next year to discuss it with the commissioners prior to applying for next year.
I don't know why we would want to turn down $74,000 that we would have to make up for in county funds.
That's straight funding. That's not.
That's correct.
Matching money.
You know, I see no reason why not to let you go ahead. I mean, you know, when the time comes to do it.
A motion.
I need to make a motion. So, well, I'll make a motion to give you the authority to apply for the grant when it comes available.
Okay. And like I said, I'm going to bring it up again next August so that we can catch this. I was remiss this year and I didn't get it before y'all.
Right. Well, I mean, with you know, when I say that, I mean also just to let us know that you're doing it. But yeah, you know, go ahead.
I'll second to that.
Okay, I have a motion made and second to let you apply for this grant. Any further discussion?
Have we already accepted these funds? Have they already gone through the process?
This grant is set up to where the county will pay for the things, and then this grant reimburses the county. So, no, $73,000.
But we don't need to do anything with approve or accept. All we're doing is applying for the next one.
Yes.
Okay. Any more questions? All right, we'll vote on the motion. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. And we didn't get a motion on the report, so.
Have a
motion, second, and a second. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Motion carried.
Thank you,
Ms. Duke.
Thank you.
All right. Correctional Work Center report.
Good.
Some of you that may have been following the agenda, I didn't mention this at the beginning. There were 10 items on here. There are actually only 9. Ambulance service report was mentioned twice on there. And we're not going to give you the opportunity to report twice. We didn't want to do that to you twice. So we basically followed the way that it was given to us in order. So that's what we're doing here. So number one wasn't on there tonight, so we started from there. Okay, sir.
Start with the minutes from the last board meeting on October 5th. Just covered expenditures we normally do. We're talking about we had spent over $2,000 to repair some vehicles, just to keep the board aware of that. Hoop a fence, install some razor wire on the perimeter, tighten up the security. And make sure them all our reports with a little pickup, monthly work report, commission checks, a couple of the vendors. Also introduced Kara Smotherman. She's here today with Rain Saddlefield to give you all a report on the reentry case manager with the guidance center. This one, you know, I told y'all the last one, that give you all updates on the grant, and because we're really trying to push to keep those positions when the grant ends in September of next year. Work release program is going well. We had a former offender belonged to a group, wanted to come in and perform for the inmates, so that scheduled that on October 18th, and it went great. This past Saturday, we did the Redeem for Life with New Vision, and our chaplain, who's also the chaplain of the Sheriff's Department, put that together. It was an awesome event. It was from 10 to 2:30. And AJA, American Jail Association, has been giving everyone updates on the FCC ruling, and we're going to get some more solid information on that. Actually, we have a meeting with our phone vendor to kind of give us the more technical aspects of what the FCC ruling, how it's going to affect not just us, but everyone in the correction field from the feds to the county level. Next, we had the state litter pickup. We received 270631 for the month of October. And the yearly activity report reflects our average census. Average Dale population has been 206. You see the felony days and misdemeanor days. Programs are going great. Nothing else really to highlight on that report. Work release program, same thing, has been going pretty good. We had one inmate that was hired full time, two additional inmates completed the program, but were not hired. Usually in that situation, they probably had a previous job that took them back, but for the most part, most of these guys are being hired by these jobs that are doing the program with us. We're very blessed to have that. And the last page is the monthly worker report for September, showing the savings to the county for the labor, and it's $145,840. If you want to approve that, and I'll have the young ladies come up to explain the grant in more detail.
We're always glad to see savings like that. That's really good. Any other questions while we have the superintendent here? Good evening, glad to have you with us.
Hello.
So this is Rain Saddlefield, Karen Smotherman.
Okay, I'm good. We'll go ahead and approve the report superintendent's given us.
Make a motion to approve.
Motion?
Second.
Second. Any discussion on the report? If not, all those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Okay, ladies.
Well, I'm Rain Satterfield. I'm the therapist in the reentry and treatment program that we have at the Work Center. I don't know how much you guys are familiar with it or not, but we got the grant money in October of last year and started actually offering services in December. So we're coming up to about a year now of actually offering those services. So really kind of the goal of this program is to reduce recidivism, to work on mental health issues, substance abuse issues, and trauma.
and help people to, those involved, to be successful when they go home, to have the resources that they need in the community. So while they're involved with us, we do intensive therapy individually and in groups, and we do case management. So we work on important issues that they have, those barriers that are really keeping them from being successful, that are holding them back, but then also working on them for their re-entry piece back into the community. So looking at safe housing, employment, education, those resources that they need, along with working through sobriety, working on their mental health issues, getting them set up to continue treatment once they leave too. So kind of, I guess, some numbers to look at where we've reached so far. So this is through September. So we don't have this updated for October yet, but to date we've screened 170 inmates. So they're referred, either they refer themselves or they referred by a staff member if they may have some concerns. So we've screened 170 to see if they are eligible for our program. Out of that, 133 of those have actually showed having substance abuse and mental health issues, co-occurring disorders. 116 of those have also had trauma events in their life, traumatic things that are affecting them. So out of that 170, we've accepted 78 of those. A little more than half have been male, less than half female. Out of those 78, 59 of them have already been released. Once they get released, for the 6 months after their release, we stay connected to them, at least through phone calls, making sure, trying to keep one, data on seeing their success rate and seeing if there's anything else, you know, we can kind of help them with. So six people have actually successfully completed the program through that full term so far. The post-incarceration information, that re-entry piece, it's been a little bit difficult to keep up with, you know, having those phone numbers and having that contact once they get out. But we have shown some success. They've either gotten involved with the Guidance Center, been in other kind of transitional programs, transitional housing programs. Some got their GED before they left, others had plans on continuing that once they get out. Every single person has gone to some kind of safe housing. No one's been homeless. Many have actually had employment before they even left, and then several right after they've left too. So some of the stability has been there for a lot of them, at least. So, and then we just continue to track it. Anything else to add?
No, not really. Basically covered everything. I'm Kara Smotherman, the case manager with this program. Basically my job, screening and assessment, resource referral, and then after they leave, I'm the person who does all of the follow-up. So when she said that follow-up's difficult, I was like, yes, very difficult. People getting in contact with them and then actually making them answer the phone and all of that can prove difficult, but we have had quite a few who I've talked to, and they've maintained the same employment for 6 months, and they've, you know, furthered their education, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah. And I guess kind of another added note to this, we're working on making an advisory council right now, so getting some community stakeholders involved to connect us with resources so we can all be involved, so that when our clients are released, there are people in the community willing to take them in and support them, and so we can all kind of work together. And we're also working on getting some trainings in order for the work center, for the staff on mental health, on substance abuse, things like that, to kind of help them better, you know, deal with inmates as well.
As people finish your program, do you add others too?
Yes, we're constantly getting new ones in and people leaving. I think on average between 30 and 40 at a time is about what we see.
Okay. You said you had 170 and I believe you said you chose 78.
Yes.
Will the ones that weren't chosen that time be re-looked at for the next openings or not?
Well, so usually the main reason why we don't accept people are usually because they have limited time. They get out too soon. So we'll try to get them appointments with the Guidance Center or some other community resource so that they have that connection when they leave. And then others, maybe they weren't interested or they just didn't quite meet the criteria, but it's always open if something comes up for them to come back in.
When you were listing some of those stats about mental health and past trauma, mm-hmm. what's the litmus test or criteria to determine that this was a crisis event in someone's life? Is it a death of a family member? Is it family being incarcerated? How's that determined? Because mental health is a big public conversation now, you know, related to gun violence and just other things in general in society. So what's the criteria that you use to say this individual meets the criteria that we're using to say there's mental health challenges or there's been a crisis moment? Yeah, whoever can answer.
So as I was talking about screening, mm-hmm. that's this lady.
Okay.
So we do have three tools that we use. One is a mental health, second is a substance abuse, and the last is about life events. So okay. there's a list of about 20 life events that kind of are categorized by being trauma related. So that's witnessing fire and explosion, seeing or being a part of an assault, a rape, anything of that nature.
Okay, so do they just meet one of those 20, or do they got to meet five of the 20 to be considered a crisis moment type deal? Because I would think in society, given that list is 20, there's a lot of people that might meet mm-hmm. one or two of those, mm-hmm. but not meet eight of those. So how do you?
It's a conjunction of all three. So you have to take
okay.
Each of the separate screenings and assessments and kind of look at them from a holistic approach.
Gotcha. So it's a sum that meets a whole eventually.
Exactly.
In the evaluation.
Exactly. Okay. And is this still affecting you today?
So, right.
You know.
Gotcha.
And
okay.
also, we use those screenings just to kind of see if they're eligible originally for the program. But once they get in, we do diagnose. And so, I would, mm-hmm. As far as post-traumatic stress, I would actually go through that criteria to see if they met that.
Gotcha.
To see if it's still actually affecting them
right.
in a great way.
Okay.
So.
Good. Thank you.
And to add to that, like I said, this program is really, we've seen it working mm-hmm. with the behavior and with the reentry part. And, it takes time to actually see the results down the road. But a year out, going into next year, definitely, they'll have a more lengthier time to assess the ones they've been, reaching out to, especially the reentry part. It's the biggest part.
Right.
And one of the things that we are working on right now with Deputy Mayor is, the pre-sentencing issue about who should be detained. And one of the things we learned last week, we had a meeting, it was last week, and we found out is the way to look at this thing is a linear thing instead of a program.
Mm-hmm.
And this is one of the aspects of it. We need to start catching these people at point of arrest to do some assessment to say, we can work with this person outside the boundaries of confinement by getting them help in the public side with a lot of nonprofits, organizations like Volunteer Behavioral, Doors of Hope. There's a lot of Alcoholics Anonymous to really target why they keep coming back to jail instead of saying, "Oh, you're going to jail, and we'll figure it out then." And that's the way that in the long run we'll see the cost savings, because I can tell we're getting ready for a big population surge for this community. I seen an email today about a transit meeting coming up soon. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, they start talking mass transit, that means they're really expecting an explosion. We have to stay ahead of this curve. I know we talked about building new facilities and all that, but there are too many other tools, and especially in this community, that we can use to try to alleviate spending $200 million on a new facility.
Yeah.
That's just my input. I appreciate y'all listening to what they had to say today.
That's good, thank you.
Now, do y'all want us to come once a month or maybe quarterly, because their stats is monthly. They can, so I don't know how often.
Should just include that in your report on
okay.
a monthly basis, and then maybe quarterly or
they can
whatever.
Contact.
Then
right. I'm sure they're glad to hear that. Right. Well, I appreciate it.
And any other questions? If not. Appreciate you being
all right.
here.
Thank you for
being
thank
here.
You.
Thank you for being here. Appreciate what you did. I believe OSHA reports are next one.
Evening.
Good evening.
Should have the report there in front of you for the month ending September. And you'll notice that we had 22 injuries requiring medical attention. You can see how the breakout there is. That brings the total for the year to date to 145. Of that 145, 93 of them are OSHA recordable, 41 have restricted days to the claims, 31 had lost days, and 21 were all others. If you look at the next page, you'll see according to the graph, we're comparing this year to the two previous years, and you can see it pretty much still running cyclic like you do in most of the previous 2 years. We are down right now as far as total claims report. We're at 145. Well, last year we were at 172. Of course, 2 years ago we were at 141, so slight up from 2 years ago, but definitely down from last year. The next page, however, shows the dollars incurred, and we are up on the dollars. We've had a couple injuries in the a couple months that kind of pushed us up a little bit, and we're up, of course, as I've mentioned previously, you know, those dollars until they're spent, it's hard to assess what it's finally going to come out to be. Those dollars obviously are estimates on what it's going to take to close a claim, and they could actually come down some before that's done.
Or go up.
Or go up. Yes, sir. You are correct. It could be more extensive. So what you can take away from this is while the claims are actually down, we've had several claims that are a little bit more serious in nature. So the claims that we are having are a little bit more serious, and people need to pay closer attention.
You know where they were coming from?
I can tell you that. If you remember back in April, we had a couple of things happen in the school system. There was a student assault that made the newspapers, and that pushed a couple of things. There's also one in the highway department that had a fracture that was actually also pushed the envelope as far as surgery and things like that. So those couple of claims are the ones that actually pushed that up. Out of the 22 claims that were reported for the month of September, the total dollars right now are a little less than $37,000, at $36,842. The claims, the Board of Education had a total of 12 claims, and the dollars incurred there were $16,600. The highway has one claim in the month of September, and it's cost of is estimated at $3,100, and the county general had the other nine, and it's estimated at $17,000. And the last page of your report, you'll see there, you'll see where those claims are, the nine for the county general, within the sheriff's department, ambulance department, correctional work center, and one here in the courthouse also. That's all I have at the moment for the report.
Okay.
I had a couple of things I just want to kind of bring to everybody's attention, since this is also out of the risk management office, the injuries. Insurance right now is going on. Big thing for the county this month. Open enrollment is going on. The last day for open enrollment is October the 2nd, which is next Monday at noon. It closes. November. Sorry, got my month mixed up. November 2nd, next Monday at noon, open enrollment ends. And so every employee that is benefit eligible has to go in and look at their benefits. If they don't go in, they could actually lose their health insurance under the Affordable Care Act. Because every employee that benefit eligible, they have to either accept health insurance or decline it. And so that's one of the things that's going on. Also, by November the 30th, going on is to know your numbers and your health risk assessment. All employees that are benefit eligible need to go in and do those, know your numbers and your health risk assessment. Otherwise, there's a wellness fee that could be within given to them as a result of their failing to do that. And then because of open enrollment, if you have anybody who has new dependents being added to the health insurance this year. The deadline for dependent verification is December the 1st to get that documentation in. And I would just remind all county employees that if you have questions about this, there's a lot going on right now, pick up the phone and call the risk management office. Our number is 898-7715. 898-7715. Call us and we'll see what we can do to help you. We're actually, last week and this week, we're running some split hours. Half the office is working at coming in at 7 in the morning and working to 3:30, and the other half is coming in at 9 and working to 5:30. So we have the office open from 7 in the morning to 5:30 at night last week and this week. So somebody's there to help you. We also man it all during the lunch hours and everything like that. So please just remember, if you haven't gone online and done your open enrollment, you must do that if you're eligible for those benefits. And if you need help, we're here to help you.
Can you tell if those numbers are down yet from last year, up as far as individuals that have already signed
back up? We have somewhere in the neighborhood, and I hate because these numbers are a little old, but as of toward Thursday of last week, we only had about 800 people who have actually gone on and done their open enrollment, and we've got over 5,000 people on the benefits. So we got a lot of people need to go on there and do that. And
right.
In years past, employees have not had to do anything and it would automatically roll over and they'd have the same thing that they had last year. The Affordable Care Act will not allow that to happen. You've got to go on and select your benefits, and if you don't, you will lose your health insurance coverage. So that's a big one. And then I just remind everybody, and everybody I say, I ask them if they've done their health or their open enrollment. And also, if you are a supervisor or a department head and you have people in your department that do not have email, please reach out to them, because we're sending out a lot of stuff by email. And yeah, there's people out there that don't have email in their position and they need to be informed about this. So please make sure you're reaching out to them.
When is the deadline?
The deadline for open enrollment is November the 2nd, next Monday at noon. And it'll lock at noon, and no matter what, we can't get it changed, nobody will change it. When it's done, it'll lock up and we won't be able to go back in and change it.
You're fixing to really be busy. You got 4,200 people coming to see you.
Well, you can do it online. I mean, okay. They don't have to come into our office, all 4,200
of them. Long hours.
But
he knows he's telling you, it's online.
Yeah.
But
now,
you gotta get it done. I mean, and unfortunately, you know, we're just trying to reach out there and shake the tree, make sure people know that it's got to be, it's there. So.
Any other questions? Okay, we need his report approved.
Make a motion to approve the report as presented.
Motion.
Second.
And second. Any discussion further? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Gregory, I believe, for Hawes. Good, it's ready for you.
All right. For the month of September, we had 637 animals enter into the shelter. Of those animals, we had 201 that were adopted out, 213 that were humanely euthanized, 172 that were reclaimed by their owner, a few that were dead on arrival or deceased at the shelter, and 21 other outcomes. I'm pretty proud of our adoption reclaim percentage. We're seeing that number go up. For the first 4 months of this fiscal year, we've averaged over 200 adoptions each month, which we haven't seen that since before everybody's Great Recession in 2008. So we're getting back to those numbers, which is exciting. Our dog adoption reclaim percentage too at 82.5%, very tickled over that, and anxious to keep that that number there. Our live release rate for the month was 63.3%, and 131 of the reclaimed animals were from the surgery programs. We had 2,104 people visit the shelter looking for a lost or new pet, and 2,297 logged calls and voicemails for the month. We had 1,543 calls received and 1,551 calls that were closed out by the officers. And you can see the breakdown by jurisdictions of those. And we traveled 9,747 miles. Year to date, we've had 1,983 animals enter into the shelter. You can see the adoption reclaim percentage is 48.8%.
and our live release rate of 51.7% since July 1st. We've had 4,861 calls and 4,859 calls closed out, and we've traveled 33,218 miles. Our bite report for the month, we had 39 bites that were reported to us. One of those animals were sent off for rabies testing, did not come back positive. We had 6 other exposures, one of those sent off as well, and no positives there.
Let me ask you, are we not getting into the season as far as the skunks?
We had 3 or 4 calls today for folks that requested removal for skunks. Those were folks that had not, since we changed the rules over to not picking those up, these were folks that this is the first one they had called since that, so of course we went out and did that. Thankfully, we're not getting the number of calls recently anyway for you know, sick, injured, those type things, which has been good. But I mean, you can look down for the year since January. Out of those 9 that were positive or unsatisfactory, 8 of those were skunks.
Okay. Any questions anybody has?
Back on your other report. Mm-hmm. In several of the columns, you have dogs and then cats, and then you have others. Mm-hmm. What is others?
Others are going to be your wildlife, anything that doesn't fit into that category of dogs and cats. It could be somebody surrendering a rabbit. We've got a pot-bellied pig in the shelter right now. We've had goats. anything that doesn't fit in those dog or cats is going to go into that.
Okay.
Other. Yeah. You just never know.
Listeners, what are you going
to do? You know, we've actually discussed possibly. You know how they do the jail for fundraisers, you know, you come into jail. We've actually talked about turning one of our rooms into for a day. You get to come spend a day in the kennel. So y'all might ought to be scared over that.
I was going to say, you wouldn't get much on us. They'd leave us there. Okay. Any other questions? Anyone? Ask Mr. Gregory. We'll go ahead and prove it. I think you got something else.
I've got
for
a couple
ours.
Of things.
Okay, we'll go ahead and prove your report. There's a motion. So we have a motion. We have a second. And a second. Any further discussion? If not, I'll call the vote. And all those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Okay, one thing that I've got is one of the state representatives for Rutherford County had contacted us, and this was something that had been on my radar for a couple of years anyway, just didn't quite know how to go about this. With us being located right next to the interstate, we've been there since 2004. There's quite a few mature trees and there's quite a bit of undergrowth right there by the interstate that completely blocks the view from the interstate of our facility. He had mentioned that if I would type a letter up and ask for some of your all's signatures, that he would be happy to take that and see if he could get TDOT to come in and clear out some of that growth, leave the mature trees, so that when, you know, we have thousands of folks traveling down the interstate every day, they'd see our facility and make it much more visible. I've spoken to the mayor. He signed the letter. Deputy to the mayor, Jeff Davidson, is going to sign it this evening. I'd like to pass this around. If you are interested in signing it, I'd like your signature so that I could forward that to him to see if that would be possible or not. So I'll leave that with you. I'll pick that up at the end of the meeting. The next thing is, I was notified of a grant through PetSmart Charities. Didn't know that it was even open, and I went ahead and applied for it. Didn't think that we would get it, but I got word last week they were asking some follow-up questions on it, and then they called this morning to say that we are going to be receiving the grant. Typically, most of these places don't fund any personnel expenses. This one indicated that one of the things they would fund were personnel to help increase adoptions. So we applied for $18,000 to try to get someone that would staff our mobile adoption unit. One of the things that we have happen quite often are folks that call wanting the unit to come, but we simply don't have the staff to send out. This would be a part-time person that would be dedicated to making sure that unit would go out. We also had to set a goal with PetSmart to increase our adoptions just through the unit to 450 adoptions per year. Out of this $18,000 to make it work out correctly, to pay for the salary, the Social Security, and the Medicare, it would require us to spend $137 out of our calls budget to make the math work. Due to vacancies and whatnot, we do have the money available in the Social Security and Medicare to cover that. So we're spending $137 to get $18,000. I'm asking your permission for the amendment, plus your permission for the mayor to sign and execute and do everything he needs to do when the contract does come.
Okay, you've heard the request. We're wanting to spend $137,000 to get $18,000. Is that
yes, sir.
The way I see that?
Yes, sir.
I wished I could do my money like that.
I'd write quite a few of those checks.
I'll make a motion, Mr. Chairman. We approve the budget request as presented.
All right. We're going to have to
accept. Have we received the grant money yet?
We have not. It's to, from when I spoke with the mayor this morning, it's to do the budget amendment as well as allow him to sign, execute everything
accept
he has to do
it.
To make it work.
Yeah, that's
accept it.
Yes.
Okay. Do we not need to do a roll call on this? Mm-hmm. Okay. I guess we've got the motion and the second, so I guess we need
Who
to
was the second?
Second.
Okay. Commissioner Gurley?
Yes.
Commissioner Nipper?
Yes.
Commissioner Piercy?
Yes.
Commissioner Serino?
Yes.
Commissioner Turner?
Yes.
Commissioner Reed?
Yes.
Thank you all.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay, we're ready for ambulance service report. It's made it twice.
I was, got one, I was one and eight. Can you pick the eight?
You know, this was done by SharePoint. It was not done by the chairman. I explained that to you. I did not do that. That's why SharePoint handed it to me. So that's.
I understand. All right. We're going to the first page here, and on the first page, there's really nothing outstanding that has changed, except for, of course, the runs are getting more and more and more, and we're getting busier and busier and busier. I know you've heard the fire department say that. And, rescue is saying that, and we're also saying that we're being taxed as far as run numbers go. The next part of the page is just basically what our ambulances are running. The ones that you see in yellow are our spares, and then the rest of them are online ambulances. The bottom of this page actually is shown better and later in the report, but we'll talk about that just a little bit. The next page is the in-service training and what each one of our special operations have done and standbys and things like that. Next page is a breakdown of our ambulance stations and the response times and on-scene times. On-scene times are looking really good. Response times are creeping up. We're at 8.1, which is, we've been there for the last 2 or 3 months. We would really like to see 6.0.
That means you've got to be closer, right?
Yeah, we've got to be closer. The next one are just a breakdown of the district calls, which you guys like to see that, and how many calls are being made in your district. And same thing for the year to date on the next page. And this page really shows kind of a pattern of when we're going in and out of each one of the zones. I told you that on the first page, it kind of reflected that. This kind of tells you which zones that each one of these ambulances are running in and out of, and MTSU being probably our busiest zone, which is zone 4 there, and closely followed by Salem Road, which is zone 1. And then the rest of the report are thank you letters and good jobs and the WGNS.
It's great. Always good to get those.
Absolutely. I'll be happy to entertain any questions.
You Anyone have any questions?
Make a motion to approve.
Have a motion to approve. Have a second?
Second.
Have a second. Any further discussion?
How close are you on the number of runs you're getting and how many you can run?
I know for a fact that there were about seven times this month alone that we have had to use administrative personnel to cover calls, ambulance calls. I made two of them personally, so it's getting critical. It's getting critical. So, you know, when we run out of units, we never run out of ambulances because we have administrative staff that, you know, I can field 20 ambulances probably in about 22 minutes. Of course, you know, if we're there during the daytime, it's really easy for us to get on board, and that's what happened in all seven of these cases, thank goodness, but it is getting to be a critical situation. The infrastructure just needs to be reworked, I think.
Any plans or foresight on that?
We do. We actually have a five-year plan that we're upgrading right now, and we're going to present that to the mayor, you know, and then I'm sure it'll go to you guys.
Okay. Any other questions? If not, we'll call for the vote. All those in favor of the commission report, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. I believe you've got a budget.
We do. This is good stuff. We got a donation from the physicians at St. Thomas Rutherford for our scholarship fund, and that's what this is, just moving that money into the fund where we pay the scholarships.
Okay. About $6,000? Have a request.
Make a motion that we approve the request as presented.
Second.
Have a second. Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Gurley?
Yes.
Commissioner Nipper?
Yes.
Commissioner Piercy?
Yes.
Commissioner Turner?
Yes.
Commissioner Reed?
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes.
You're running me off.
I believe the sheriff's report.
Last but least.
Yes.
Oh, I hope it's least.
Oh, yeah. It's an internal move.
Here's yours. All right. Didn't come with an entourage tonight.
That made the meeting a lot shorter, won't it? You guys appreciate that. For tonight, I've got just the one amendment I need to do. It's an internal move on the jail budget. Prisoner transport, which is extraditions, they have gone through the $20,000 already, and for this year they've got to move some. So they were planning on building a GED classroom out on site, so we're going to half that money for now and move $20,000 from that budget into the transport extradition line item. $20,000 may get them to the end of this calendar year, but not the budget year. So, because I was looking at the extradition list, what they've got coming up, and it's not looking good. So we may end up moving the rest of this money later on in the spring. And that's all I have.
Okay, you've heard the request, gentlemen. Any questions?
And the money was for what?
Extraditions. It's where they go out and the district attorney says go get them, and they've got to go get them. We've been using a company called PTS and ICS, and that saves some money. It just depends on schedule, but they've just had so many. It's quite a volume. I was looking at it myself, and it's quite a bit.
But the money you're wanting to move was to build what?
A GED classroom that they were going to build on site. We may still find a way to do that and pull that off. I don't know. Depends on how creative they get on site out there. I don't know.
Was that not their first request? Was they were needing something like the portable classrooms we had?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I remember that.
And I think they decided to build something. Maybe, I don't know. I don't know what the latest decision is on that.
So the permanent classroom.
Right.
They've got an awesome GED program out there, so. They've got quite a few. I was sitting there looking at the list. This is pending. There's probably 20 names on here, and then there's another 10 that are coming up within the next couple months, and they're all over the place. They're all over the country. So they're burning it up.
What was the original request for transfers?
I think it was 25. Last year it was 25,000. I don't know what it was this year. I think originally it was 20 or 25, and then it was given at 20. Now it's been as high, I'll say, in times past. 08, 09, it was 85,000. That's what they spent. That's what they spent. They originally budgeted that year only 25,000, so they had to move quite a bit of money that year. Past couple years, it's only been about $30,000, so it hasn't been that bad. But this year, the numbers are up.
But these are prisoners captured somewhere else.
Right.
That our district attorney said, you've got to go get them. Because we want to prosecute them.
Right. And technology is kind of what's getting us, because the more information they put in NCIC, the more people they find, so right. The more people they got to go get. So it's kind of one of those self-defeating kind right. of things. So,
I'll make a motion that we approve the budget request as it is at this time.
Okay, we have a motion for the approval of the $20,000. Do I have a second? I have a second. Further discussion? I'll call for the vote. Would you?
Commissioner Gurley?
Yes.
Commissioner Nipper?
Yes.
Commissioner Piercy?
Yes.
Commissioner Serino?
Yes.
Commissioner Turner?
Yes.
Commissioner Reed?
Yes.
Beyond that, I've got the Sheriff's Office and Jail monthly report. Of course, the only real item we had to note, I think, in that report would have been the extradition line item. There's a few where the funds are spent down, but that's where they signed up their contracts for the year. That's where they've gotten purchase contracts for the year.
Are any of these, Joe, you thinking you might have to come back by the end of the year? I mean, I know it's yeah. subjective, but you know, sometimes you see trends and patterns yeah, on, you know, just, we're not going to make it on this one.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm thinking that food's probably going to be a problem as usual because right. there's so many people. Even though you guys did up that line item this year, I know that one's probably going to be an issue. It's already at 56%. We're only 4 months into it, so we're going to watch that one.
About overtime?
Overtime seems to be okay right now. The comp time is an issue, but we're working on that. So it seems to be going okay right now. I don't see an issue on that one, but I may end up eating those words, so you never know.
Yeah, it's 50.
Well, it takes right a couple disasters. And
yeah, right now it's 58%.
Yeah. But that's not all operating. That's those comp balances that can come back to bite us. They hit those pretty heavily at the beginning of the year.
Senior prisoner transport.
Yeah.
4.4%.
Yeah. But we'll see. It's just October.
Trick or treat.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else?
No, I don't know if you needed to vote on this or not. Sometimes I'll do something.
We vote on your report.
I don't have anything else in the report tonight.
Okay.
Of course, I think you've already got this part from your monthly stats to look at.
Any further questions on the report?
Make a motion. We approve the report as presented.
I have a motion. I have a second. Any further discussion? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Report's approved.
Cool. Only thing I've got left is hand out some accommodations.
About saving money and sending us these electronically.
I'd be glad to do that. I don't have a problem with that. I mean, if y'all don't mind.
This just eventually winds up in recycle. That would save.
Double time.
You know, it's just send us all this electronically and we can
be glad to. I'll let them know.
Make it, you know, it's just a few pennies, but.
Oh, yeah.
Adds it.
You're totally fine to do that. Okay. Thank you for your time.
Joe, I've got one question, or Mr. Chairman, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Go ahead.
And I certainly don't mean this to embarrass anyone, but I am concerned about it. How is the morale of the department, given some of the publicity that we've got?
It's doing very well. Yeah, they're just back to being fun, happy, and chipper again.
Well, the reason I'm asking that is, even if you're not directly involved in it, you can certainly feel an impact if you're involved in the organization. And I know, you know, whether it be my company, your job, anyone's up here, anytime you see where you work in the news, good, bad, or indifferent, there's an impact on you.
Right.
And I want you to make sure you share this with the sheriff. I thought he might be here. I was going to tell him the same thing. But since you're here, I want to share it with you because it's all applicable. Make sure that they know the Public Safety Committee appreciates what they do and that the community certainly appreciates what they do and completely understand that things are going to happen and that not everybody's lumped into the bad, not everybody gets lumped into the good, but they need to know sometimes it's okay to get a pat on the back from people that are seeing where they're at. And I want you to make sure that you relay that to your employees at the Sheriff's Department, that we appreciate what they're doing and the community appreciates what they're doing too.
Okay.
So please share that with them.
Yeah, our guys are, you know, the consummate professionals. They you know, they roll with the good, bad, and the ugly, and they definitely see their share of the ugly that they have to deal with.
Right.
But, you know, they've all, like all of us, have gone through worse things, but
sure.
I think they've done very well. I think they've handled everything very well, and everybody's seeing me back to a good mood again, so we'll see. I'm only been back 2 weeks. So,
yeah.
You know, anyway. Y'all have a nice evening.
Thank you.
Okay, we are now into other business, and I believe our deputy mayor has something for us.
I do have one more thing I want to hand out. In August, we submitted a letter of interest to the Office of Criminal Justice Programs for the state of Tennessee for a pretrial risk assessment pilot. The grant is for $360,000 approximately to establish a pretrial risk assessment program or pretrial services program. The grant is administered by the Crime and Justice Institute, and loaded into your digital devices is in the read ahead is the annual report for the Community and Resources for Justice 2014 annual report. They've distributed about $30 million for similar projects across the nation. There's also an article in there about pretrial risk assessments for you to take a look at. Apparently our letter of interest has served as an application. We didn't think it was an application, but it served as an application. And I got the letter, the email that says, congratulations, we're still in the hunt. Two of the people that are going to be providing we'll have a telephonic interview scheduled for Wednesday, November 4th from 12:30 to 1:30 p.m. to continue to compete for this $360,000. Two of the people who are going to be conducting that interview are also people that have written this article right here, so we're going to study this article a little bit. But whether we get this grant or not, and what I'm doing tonight is asking for your approval to go ahead and go forward with the grant, because all we had done so far was submit the letter of interest. We're expecting some type of application process. We need your approval to go forward with the grant request. But whether we get this grant request or not, we're still going to go forward, and we're working on a pretrial services program We're going to start off with a pilot on a GPS tracking device. So the pre-trial risk assessment would identify those people that would be low risk, okay, that we could put a GPS tracking device on and release them until their trial, or potentially it could be a diversion sentence where they could have the GPS tracking device on them and a judge would have that as part of their sentence. But for us, it's really to divert those people who would be sitting in jail waiting for their trial. So whether we get this grant or not, we're going to continue to go forward and work out the details for a pretrial services program. Just to let you know, we're working on those details. Bernard talked about it. We went to Nashville last Friday and talked to the Davidson County Sheriff's Department and talked to their pretrial services program director about what they're doing and how it's working. So our Criminal Justice Coordinating Council will meet next Friday and take a look at an outline for the program. And once we get those details worked out, we'll bring it to you and show you where we're going. We hope that this grant could be something to help us facilitate that program. But we'll come to you tonight to ask for permission to go forward with this grant request.
Is there any county money involved? Is this a matching grant or is this a complete federal 100% grant?
That we don't have full detail on. What they said was there could be some matching funds, but we can work through those matching funds in regards to work in kind of some of the personnel in your department. I would expect to have some people in Bernard's department working on this, so we think we may not have to match any grants, any grant money.
That requires very good documentation to satisfy. Been on some of those types of grants before.
You mentioned, Commissioner, go ahead.
Go.
Thank you. You mentioned that we did not, well, all we did was send an email, but in their letter they said discuss the vetting form you completed. Was the email what they defined as a vetting form?
No, we did answer some questions.
Okay.
They asked, they did send back a questionnaire, said what, in terms of reports that we shared.
Okay.
We did give them a sample, send them a sample of some of the reports that are produced in the Sheriff's Department.
Okay.
That we have been sending back and forth to people in the Criminal Justice Coordinating Council since we got that started. But in my opinion, we really haven't applied for a grant.
I just didn't know if that was a canned email they sent out that they might have got caught, you know, just sending a canned one because we sent an email, but it sounds like we did fill some information. That's fine, I was just curious.
Now, is this only going to affect the work center? I mean, you keep saying Bernard.
Right now, we would run this program out of the Correctional Work Center for a couple reasons. He's the only organization that has a diversion program. He also, in terms of the GPS tracking device, he's already using that GPS tracking device in his work release program. So they're familiar with how it operates, and that's the reason we'd be using Bernard.
This is the same program that you're working with the other judges to come up with a way to alleviate overcrowding?
Correct.
So if I'm trying to understand right, the program that you're trying to work with judges on to alleviate overcrowding is only for the work center.
No, it's for those people that are in the jail,
right?
Okay, waiting for a hearing, a
right.
sentencing.
True, I understand that, but I'm trying to understand that we have an overcrowding in the jail.
Right.
But if this program is only for the work center, then I don't see how it benefits.
It's to alleviate overcrowding in the jail. It'd be administered at the work center.
It would be administered, and they would be overseeing it there.
Correct.
And it would help alleviate overcrowding at the jail.
Correct.
Okay.
Not the work center.
Not the work center, okay.
The work center is already sentenced.
Right.
Individuals.
Well, I mean, except for the ones who are being sent over from the jail, right?
They're sentenced people. The work center does not have any pending trial people. That's all held at the jail. So if we're going to divert people out pre-trial and so on, then it's going to have to impact the jail. That's where the impact's going to be. So I just want to make sure we're heading down the right trail, because if we don't, we're not talking about people. It's a whole different thing about dealing with tracking and so on, sentenced inmates who are on work release versus someone who gets arrested today, and we're going to declare them low risk. Instead of holding them in jail, we're going to put a GPS monitoring device on them. The one advantage I see of that, we'll know where they are when they commit the next crime, if it works.
Well, hopefully they won't commit the next crime. A lot of research indicates that the sooner you get someone out of jail, the less possibility that they'll recidivate. And that's one of the things that's driving the release of this grant money.
Yeah, I agree that staying in jail, I mean, that's just kind of like going to a social club for learning the wrong time. Mm-hmm.
And I believe that's what was already said here tonight. Mm-hmm. Said if you catch them soon enough, that we may can do some training, I guess, is what we can do. Any other questions?
I would like to see you in this call Wednesday to ask for more information regarding matching funds.
Sure.
And how much the county might be asked, because I think if we're counting on just strictly in-kind contributions, that could become a headache in terms of when they're working, because like I said, I haven't been involved in other federal grant type of activity.
That's a good point.
It becomes very difficult to, okay, he's only doing business on this federal grant versus this, so ask, please. Okay.
Make a motion that we approve the request from the deputy mayor to proceed with the
second.
Okay, we got a motion to proceed and a second. Any further discussion?
Applying for it.
Okay, all those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Go forward.
Super.
Good
deal. Thank you.
Okay, any other business we might have tonight? If not, we are adjourned. Oh.